Good evening, friends. I hope I'm audible. So we are going to have a look at the PERT. We've been looking at CPM. CPM is critical PERT method. So ideally, what is the focus or what is the aim of a project? We are looking at identifying certain requirements. Okay. So once we require the requirement, we see how we can achieve it. And we are having a triple constraint. Okay. And in the next slide, we'll just go, what is this triple constraint? And also, we'll have to adapt to the client's requirements. So you just consider that you're starting to build a house, okay? In the sense that your parents are paying a builder for building a house. You suppose the builder says he's only going to use a shade of cream, while you want a shade of, say, peach or something else. Are you going to be very happy with that builder? So this is the case everywhere. Every client has a slight requirement which you have to do. And now this is the triple constraint. This is what we call as triple constraint. So first and foremost, your in the triple constraint, you have to balance cost, you have to balance time, and also you have to balance quality. Okay, so all these things have to be matched somehow or the other. And all the three are not, if you're going to look at cost and you're going to try to make the project very fast, definitely the cost is going to go up. And you cannot have all the three at one point of time. However, you will have to balance that triple constraint. Okay, so that is the main reason why we go for the network analysis, or we do some sort of a scientific study to see how we can balance the triple constraint. So what is the principal thing anybody is looking at? We are only mainly looking at the cost. Okay, so I don't know if I told this example here, but I bought a camera stand. One person told he is going to give me a small stand also free with the camera stand. So you see, what as a customer I am looking at? I am looking at, for given money, how much I can extract. Okay, and the same thing, the seller is also interested. What he is interested, he is trying to see how much money he can make from the product he is selling. If you are selling a product, you also will try to maximize your profit. Okay, so cost is the very important criteria which you always see. And then of course, this is the three things which a project is made up of. It's made up of scope. A project has scope. What do you mean by scope? You have a defined activity which starts the work and has a defined activity which ends the work. If you are getting a contract to lay the road, they specify how the base course has to be made. Okay, maybe if it's an existing road, they'll ask you to scrape the top surface. So that forms the start of your work. And when does it end? When you have painted the median and all the other road signages, and probably kept the reflecting tabs on the road, at that time probably your work is ending. So if suppose somebody says, in addition to this, put a pedestrian bridge, that is an addition to scope. So that means it need not be something which you are going to be concerned about. Okay, so this is a very important thing. Okay, so scope is something which you will have to look at. And of course, time, you cannot be dragging your project for so many years and all that. And then of course, cost is another thing which is very fixed. Okay, so these three have to be always looked at. Okay. So these are some of the project monitoring aids. You have already seen the Gantt chart. Okay, you made a table. Okay, you made an activity table. If you remember the first step, what you do, you make an activity table, and from that you get your you can make any of the network chart or whatever you want, or the Gantt chart. And Gantt chart is nothing but a bar chart which you essentially make. Okay, and current trend is to go towards building information modeling, and we try to put in quite a lot of things. Okay, your drawing conveys two dimension of data. Okay, whatever drawing which you have done in your engineering drawing or building drawing, it contains two dimension data. What is the two dimension data? It has an x coordinate and a y coordinate information. Now what is happening? Your y coordinate is also added, the z coordinate is also added to your drawing. So you totally have a three-dimension drafting package normally. Nowadays, you are able to put in time, you can put in so many other things. So, people are bringing in a lot of information into your into your drawing or whatever you're doing. Okay, so this information can be to that level that, you know, how many bolts are there in the building, a person sitting in the computer, he'll be able to do it because his building model conveys all this information. Okay, so it means that you can you can predict the cost more accurately than what you used to do. You can track parts of the building more accurately than what you can do. Okay, so most of you are familiar with this Flipkart concept, right? If you buy a something on Flipkart, at each part you're able to track where it is. Okay, maybe it's a product from Delhi. From Delhi it comes to probably Bangalore. From Bangalore it comes to Vellore, and then it comes to your hostel for delivery. Okay, so at each point people are tracking it. In the same way today, people are tracking the building components. Okay, so all this is possible with the BIM models. Okay, so everything, like, you can see what happens if suppose you miss out an element and all the things. Of course, all this requires a lot of expertise, it requires a lot of effort also from the part of the people who program or build in this information into the model. Okay, so probably this is some where you can also consider. Okay, now when you look at this CPM and PERT and all these things, they were not originally developed only for construction activities. They were done for doing some maintenance work and stuff like that. Okay, to be profitable. Basically, they were doing all these activities to be profitable. So if you are going to use something like a CPM or PERT or some other planning technique, what is the benefit that you get? First and foremost, you are identifying all the jobs and activities at the onset. Okay, and we can also, you know, like, start and stop items in a sequence. What do we mean by this? Normally, when you start an activity in our field, it continues till the end of it. Okay, suppose excavation starts, typically you say that it is one activity. Okay, you finish one activity and then you go to the other one, and it is all in a sequential way. Okay, however, one of the things is time separation is not possible. It means that, you know, you can't actually give too much of lag or, you know, the lead items into this diagram. Okay, so this is just an offshoot which I just thought I put it in. But principally, whenever you are having ordered sequence, whenever you are having an ordered sequence, this is possible. And please think of any activity which you do. Is there any way by which you can jump an ordered sequence? Okay, even if suppose you are able to jump, you will be doing that also in a sequential way. Okay, so what is the gist, or what is it that we are trying to understand here? It is that in construction, we are having activities which are sequential, so it's quite amenable for all these network techniques we talk about. Okay, so basically you will be starting with a table. Okay, so this is a example which I used in the previous semester. I'm not going to go through the example. I'm just using this to recapitulate what we have done. We first draw the table. Okay, once we get the table, we can draw a Gantt chart if we want. Okay, this is nothing but putting all the timelines into the horizontal axis as bar charts. Okay, and if you want to go and use a tool like MS Project, you will be entering first the activities. It's very important that you know what is the work you are going to do. Okay, and it is very important that you know the sequence in which you are going to do. Okay, so if you are going to start maths, it's better to start from the numbers. You understand the number line, then probably your Fourier transforms or Fourier whatever calculus or whatever you do will make much more sense. That's the same thing which we do here also. We are trying to get the activities, whatever we want to do, we get it in sequence and then we proceed on. Okay, so first you get the activities, then you put the timelines, then you put the timelines. If you add constraints, you will be able to see connections between this Gantt chart here. Of course, if you go, MS Project will also automatically develop your network. The moment you do this, you will get your network chart out immediately. Okay, so these are the things which you go in a network diagram. I am repeating this because if you are coming to, you have two parts, the CPM and PERT. In both, this is what is going to be there. If you are going to join an organization, the thing which you need to know is, you need to know the activities. What are the activities which are associated with the work? How do you come to know about activities associated with the work? There are two ways. I'll say that it's a thing that evolves. First and foremost, you need to use a lot of common sense. Okay, like if this is going to be done, this is how it's going to, this is going to be the best way to do it. And then there are some of the things which you learn as you go along in the company, learn and grow in the company. Okay, so I'm not going to go into this, but please remember these two points which we were stressing in the last lecture. There should not be loops and there should not be any hanging notes. Okay, now, okay. Is there any point in this which you'd like me to clarify? These are the constraints. Okay, this is something which you are going to ensure it doesn't happen when you prepare your network diagram. Okay. So this is CPM, critical path method. This was done by DuPont for managing shutdown. What's the shutdown? If you look at any chemical plant or any plant, for example, this Kudankulam nuclear plant is under shutdown now. Okay, what does that mean? It means that you need to stop all activities, inspect all the critical areas. In fact, it will be like an inch by inch inspection of every aspect of the nuclear reactor. And if you're going to go for a petrochemical plant, it's the same thing that they do. Sometimes they'll have to go into the pipes and also check whether things are right. Okay, so this is a shutdown where the entire plant stops operation and then they do the checking. So this is a repetitive thing. What does it mean? If suppose you have one power plant, one thermal power plant, the similar operations are only going to be there in other thermal power plants. So this DuPont specialized in certain areas, so it could do the work in a repetitive fashion. So they used this CPM, but PERT was used for developing a missile project. So typically, if you look at some of the textbook, they'll say that CPM is good for repetitive projects and PERT is for the ones where you are going to have some research sort of, or one hand or one shot type of projects. Okay, so if you look at CPM, these are some of the things which you did, okay, or which you are supposed to do. You know that activities which are there, that's the first thing which you define, and then you put the time. If you remember the chart which we have or the table which we have, first thing you have the activities, then you have the time, then you see what comes after, then that is called a precedence. Okay, what comes before or what comes after, then you have the controls well established. What's the control? It's the constraints which you place or some of the monitoring techniques which you put. Or you say, if suppose this activity is achieved, then it is a very important part of it. So it's a milestone activity. And cost optimization is the focus. One of the things focused in CPM. So these are some of the benefits of CPM. And okay, what is contingency plan? See, if suppose you say that, you know, you are planning to do something, however, for instance, you are wanting to concrete, but it so happens that day there is a lot of, that's a big thunderstorm, and not only is there a thunderstorm, part of your excavation has collapsed. Okay, so it is a difficult situation. So what should be done to overcome the time which is being lost because of such an activity? It's not only time. If you notice, rework is always costly. You have already done the excavation. Now what you are going to do, you are again going to include manpower for doing some work. Okay, so this sort of thing, if it happens, it is going to affect your schedule very badly. Another thing which many times happens is, sometimes your buyer doesn't pay you. Okay, so you are planning to circulate the money. You get some 10 crores for a particular month. Of the 10 crore, you would have promised some suppliers to repay their loan. Okay, like you might have bought so a few tons of steel on credit. So you have to pay the money. If you don't pay, you are going to lose the credit in the rating with the supplier. He may not be willing to give you cement at another time on credit or steel on credit. So these sort of things mean that you are getting a blockade. Okay, because funds get blocked, your schedules can also get blocked. Okay, so this is if suppose such a scenario occurs. So if you look at a what if analysis, it is possible when you have the schedule done. Okay, so if you are going to look at a critical thing, you got a contingency plan in place. Okay, right. So these are some of the limitations of CPM. Okay, we've been talking a lot about CPM. So these are some of the limitations. If you start a CPM operation, it presumes that it will continue. It means that if you look at the activity chart which we drew earlier, you told that the activity takes 4 days. So what happens? Once it starts at point A or ith node, when it goes on to the jth node, you expect it to get finished. Okay, and resource dependencies are not expressed in this network, CPM network. What is this resource network? What are the resources? Time is one resource. Then people are very important resources. Then your tools and machinery. So that is not getting that is not getting reflected. And sometimes people may misuse the float which is available. Okay, we calculated a total float, but between activities also there can be float where it is dependent on the preceding activity, or whether some of the floats are depending on the succeeding activity. Okay, so you may sometimes misuse the float thinking it is available. One of the worst things that can happen in a project is that, or I can't say worst things, one of the things which can, you know, happen funnily in a project is something you would have got a path as a critical path. It may so happen that your path which you thought is very safe will become the critical path because you have not been focusing or allocating your resources in that direction. Okay, so this is what we mean by this non-critical activities becoming critical. Okay, so we come to the PERT, program evaluation and review technique. This is a probabilistic technique. What do we mean by probabilistic here? So if you look at the differences, these are some of the differences. So PERT, I am just focusing on this point a little. PERT helps you to understand on a probabilistic scale. Okay, there are a lot of uncertainties. What are these uncertainties? Okay, so these are some of the uncertainties which you can envisage. Of course, there are a lot more, but at our level, probably these are some of the uncertainties which we'll think about. Okay, so if suppose this uncertainty is there, how are we going to find out what is going to happen? So for this, PERT uses a probabilistic route. What is probability? What is probability? The likelihood of an event occurring. Okay, so how likely is it that there is going to be a delay? So they use three measures of time, and then they go ahead. Okay, but before I come to that part, you'll find that if you formalize a PERT network, it's very much the same as what you do in the critical path method network. Only difference is the time which we fix is a function of probability. So it's derived from a probability distribution. Okay, so otherwise it's much more or less the same. Okay, and another thing here also is activities, once they start, it is considered as uninterruptible. What does that mean? The moment you start concreting, there is no way by which the time takes into account that there could be a delay in the process. The time doesn't take into account delays which could happen. For instance, you start concreting, one side of the excavation caves in. That is one thing. And if you notice, in I think last week's paper, one crane had toppled over. Okay, last week, Hindu, you just go through. There was an incident where a crane toppled. Okay. Anyway, so all the other things, okay, all the other things which we talk about, all these are similar to CPM. I just wish you to go through this and see if suppose, I mean, like if you have any areas which you'd like me to touch upon. So these are the these are the assumptions. It's a beta distribution. Okay. So it's a beta distribution between the pessimistic and optimistic time. Okay, where you are not at all thinking that it's going to happen. What is optimistic time? If suppose you are going home, okay, and you are going to have a connecting flight in Chennai, you know that there is a lot of delay between the central station and coming to airport. So what do you say? On a very good day, you can reach there in 20 minutes, but if there's traffic, it will take, say, maybe even 2 hours or 3 hours, right? So you put an estimate of time on certain pre-knowledge. Okay, you know that something is going to happen. Extend it to your construction activity, you will have an optimistic time. I'll finish concreting in just one day. But if suppose I find that my formwork is not sufficient and I have to do some repair tutorial. Of course, this is not going to happen in a real thing. The most likely thing which will happen is you go to the excavation and say, if the soil is what I think it is, 2 days I'll finish excavation. However, if I encounter rock, it may take 2 weeks. So you see, the limits of time you are placing between 2 days and 2 weeks or 14 days. Okay. So this is what this is the thing which we have, and then we have a there are six divisions of time. How does it happen? Or six weights. The optimistic and pessimistic time have weight 1, but most likely time has weight 4. So 4 plus 2, you got 6. Okay. We state that activities are statistically independent. And overall, the project has normal distribution. You know what normal distribution is, right? That Bell jar curve, which you would have studied. Okay, so that's what we call as this one. And this is another assumption we do. The critical part is the longest expected value of the total project time. Okay, so these are some beta distributions which you can have. Okay, it can be any shape which you have. Both of them are optimistic and pessimistic times, and a value will be 0 and 1. However, please don't worry. In the people who have done this, they don't expect us to go and interpret these curves. Although, in all fairness, you are expected to go and study how this, how likely or unlikely you are going to have a difference. Okay, so these are you could have these curves, but we don't do that in practice. We just go ahead and use the optimistic, most likely, and pessimistic times. Okay, so as we are talking, expected time. Okay, the expected time is a weighted average, and this is the formula which we use. Okay, now I'm just going to come down a little. I have been going a little fast because I know I want to cover a lot of ground. But do you have any queries, or you know, is there any place which you'd like me to revisit? Is there any slide which you'd like me to go back? If you are having a doubt, I'm sure that most of your friends are also having the same doubt, and it's okay to ask.
Sir, upload the slide, sir.
I'll upload the slide, but now you ask me doubt which you have here.
So what do you mean by beta distribution?
See, beta distribution, it's just a mathematical distribution of how probable an event is likely to occur. Okay, so usually what people do is, to get a distribution of that sort, they'll have a collection of data. I mean, a collection of information like the growth of bacteria under various conditions. So they'll have a distribution of events under this condition and this condition. So they get a curve, and mathematically they got lot of Gaussian distribution. Like that, they got lot of distribution. One such distribution is called beta distribution.
So my question is, how is it different from?
See, I'm not critically thinking about this, but just that the fundamental idea is the normal distribution, just a normal distribution which we have. Why we use this is, it goes by the principle that if an event is likely to occur, statistically it should be lying about the mean, lying about the mean. Okay, so that is why we go for this distribution when compared to others, because I'm not in a position to explain to you the other distributions which we have. Okay, so it's something about the mean that it's likely to happen. So that's why we go for this one. Anything else?
And how IBM model used to track
How?
IBM model used to track the
promo. Crack what?
Track, as you told, like Flipkart order is, you are tracking, in IBM model you also used to track.
IBM? Okay, you are talking about this one, parts tracking, huh? Oh, BIM, okay. I was thinking, what is you're talking about IBM? So, BIM is building information modeling. See, when you're looking at, he's working on BIM. Pratik is working with BIM. So, you will find that it is almost like a virtual reality which you have, where every part is having a tag number. Every part has a tag number. So, if you're, for instance, if you have a column, it has a unique number for the entire project. So the moment you want to design it, the person has finished his structural design, he tags it. So that tag goes to the fabrication shop. So the moment it's fabricated, they'll tag it. So then what happens? It's going to in the transport. So at each point, you can track where the part is. Instead of buying a mobile phone, what you're doing is you are getting a part manufactured. You just track it along the same principle. It might be just a simple barcode which is done and you track it. So, and more advanced things are nowadays GPS based fleets. You would have heard of that, right? GPS based tracking of fleets. So because of that, you are able to track in real time where the part is. Okay. So here, what is the significance here? If you are saying that this part has to arrive at some time, when it is to arrive, you know the time. So whether it will reach, not reach, you are going to be immediately able to find out.
But how it works, is it with help of software and all?
Yes, it's with the help of software.
GPS is different thing.
Sorry?
GPS is different thing. We are putting the GPS and tracking.
Correct. See, end of the day, the software needs to know where your part is. Okay. So there can be so many technologies which can be used to spot where the part is. That's what I'm telling. You may use GPS, you may use just a barcode where it passes a particular thing, or you may have an RFID which is also being used. So the moment a part goes, the RFID is immediately tracked and tagged. So it will say part number so and so from Kanchipuram workshop, it has reached Madras port. So once it reaches Madras port, it has been loaded into ship. Ship is moving. So now you need to know where exactly in the world the ship is. So it may be a remote thing, maybe even in the Arctic Circle. So you need to know where the ship is, whether it reaches in time. That's okay. Any other questions here? Basically, your CPM and PERT is going to be the same, just that the way you calculate the time is going to be different. You give more weightage to the most probable time. And this is what you put it in the network diagram. This is what you put in the network diagram. And the beauty is, once your activity is complete, you can keep updating it in real time. So once this doesn't mean that only it's possible in PERT, you can also do in CPM. So if you had a time, you change it into the software, it is going to be done. If you look at MS project, if you take MS project, you'll find that it will have an option to tell the software how much of the activity has been completed. For instance, you can say 30% of the project is completed or 40% of the project is completed. So it can do the calculations with time, and then it can also flag you the events which are getting critical. Okay. So critical path you can compute to the usual method. Okay, you can go for a forward pass and reverse pass. Only thing is, if you're inputting the progress in real time, software will use those times, how much it has actually worked, how much of the job has been completed, and then it can go on. And earlier you gave a time, but instead of this, now we are reducing it to an expected time, because you are expecting that the work is going to be complete at a given point of time, because now you are able to update things more dynamically. Okay, so this is the variance. Okay, variance is how much scatter is there between your expected and what is going to, what is actually there. If you remember, variance is also being used in your marks, no? So variance is also used in your FFCS. Okay. So this is an example of how a PERT will look. This is taken from Wikipedia. So you will have the three time, the most optimistic time. See, I think I can finish this activity in 2 days. Normally it takes 4 days. However, worst case it will be 6 days. India-Pakistan match came, so one day went off. Okay, it's probable, right? So because of that, this job is going to get into 6 days. So these are if you remember, this is the activity and precedence, whatever is preceding it. So this will help you to draw the Gantt chart or the network diagram. Okay, this is some information which you get from the PERT analysis. When you sit, that it's most likely that you will complete your project. Again, is there a probability that you can finish the work ahead of schedule? Okay, so if you keep updating your network on a regular thing, you will immediately be able to say whether you are actually going to be able to finish it ahead of time. And also you will know the activities which are going to impact the completion time. So, you know, if you are going to look at the resource and you find that a certain activity has been completed much earlier, you can use the free time which is there or excess time which you have got to help the activity which is more critical to get complete. So what does it mean? If you identify that a particular activity is getting slow, you can and another activity which is going very fast, you can take some people or you can take some equipment from that, divert it to the place where the activities are going at a slower rate than what you want. So once you do that, you'll find that more or less both of the activities are going at the same speed. Okay. So you will also know when is the activity likely to start, when the activity is likely to end. It is very important as a planner, because you need to know what is the plant, what is the equipment which has to go, what is the material which has to be brought to that particular area, and what is the other resource like people which you have to come and bring it to a particular job, because your activity, because you know when that activity is going to start, and because you know when the activity is ending, you can take some resources from there and also go out. Okay. Then it also allows a little flexibility in scheduling. Okay, if you know that, okay, this is not that critical, I may push some material from here to there. So stuff like that you can do. And these are some of the limitations which we have. Okay. So you assume it's a beta distribution. Beta distribution is like a normal bell jar curve. So sometimes it may not be the beta distribution. Your job may not be so that you cannot have that guarantee that it is going to be about the mean. What does it mean if suppose, what is the understanding if it is not about the beta distribution? It means that this 1 plus 4 plus 1 by 6, that formula what we have, right? Optimistic time plus 4 times most likely plus pessimistic time by 6. It need not be that way. It could have been 2 times optimistic time plus 2 times or 3 times pessimistic time plus 1 time, most likely time plus 1 time pessimistic time. So this is what we mean by not being in the beta distribution. Because we assume it's the beta distribution, we are saying that 1 plus 4 plus 1. Okay, so probably I think we'll just, okay, there are too many slides to go back. Oops. I'll just look at this one. Yes, see, if suppose it is very likely that you are going to finish a time a job in time, it means that if this is the bell jar curve, it's moving very significantly towards the most likely time, the optimistic time. Okay, pessimistic time has very little value, so it means that you can as well say 2 times optimistic plus 3 times most likely plus 1 time pessimistic time. On the other hand, on this curve you don't have anything, there's no chance of finishing it on time, so this is 0 here. So probably you should say 2 times or 3 times your most likely time and 3 times your pessimistic time. Okay, so this is what I hope it clarifies a little more about this beta distribution question which you asked. Okay. So, yeah. So, assumption of project completion time is same as critical path may not be always true. Because sometimes what will happen is, you may say finishing is not very critical, but it may so happen that 4 or 5 tiles which you had in reserve also broke. Okay, so that means although that job was not very critical, what is happening? Because of non-availability of that 4 tiles, you are not able to say you finished the job. And if you go to a shop and buy tiles, you will not find the same quality or color of tiles the second time you go. So you see again what will happen. And the owner is not, if suppose you have a white wall, a white tiled wall, and 4 tiles are alone cream, your engineer is giving it to you, will you accept that job? It's very difficult to accept it. Okay, so that's what we mean by that. So these are the differences, like, you know, this is something which you can just see as to how or when you can apply CPM PERT. And these are some of the similarities which you have. Both are tools for decision making, both you draw network diagrams, both you have the same constraints, okay, both have the same constraints. And then you have quantitative, and both are quantitative, okay. And what is this unwieldy network chart? Sometimes the network chart will become so big that you can't read it on paper. If you print, it will be like from here to that end. So that is what we mean by that. And it requires a little skill. Okay, what is the skill required? You need to understand the activities which are realistically possible to take place in that particular problem or in that particular site which you are programming for. So this is what we mean by the skill required. Sometimes you miss activity, and the other problem, because the computer is going to solve it, you may put in too many activities. Okay. So these are some of the things. Please have a look at this particular website. What is this total free float in CPM, this one? And this Deep Fried Brain project, it's a nice website for those of you who are planning on a career in project management. And yeah, you can go through this beta distribution also on Wikipedia. Okay. So the the diagrams which I took for PERT were from this particular part of Wikipedia. Okay, so do you people have any other thing which you'd like to ask or share? We have gone very rapidly. Okay, we've gone very rapidly in this. So basically, in PERT, you'll find that you'll not just use time. You go in for finding out what is the optimistic time, most likely time, and the pessimistic time. So the probabilistic distribution is just that, giving you that 1 + 4 + 1. It may so happen that it is not 1 + 4 + 1, it could be some other distribution also. And in both the cases, you are going to draw the same network diagram, you are going to get the same early start, late start, etc. Going to again do the same floats, okay. And you will also get the same diagram. Okay, you will get the same diagram. Probably you will be using more of that precedence diagram which somebody was very fond of. Okay, so any questions?
So for exam purposes, you have to use 1 + 4 + 1 only.
For exam purposes, for all practical purposes, people use only 1 + 4 + 1. Unless you are so sure this is not going to happen in the optimistic time at all, or you say there is no chance of an optimistic time, this is the most likely time, or it can be so bad. So that means automatically optimistic time becomes zero. So anyway, for exam part of point of view, I'm not going to screw up that part. Okay. In fact, in the early stages, when computing power was not much, people used to do this calculation 1 + 4 + 1/6 and give the time alone for the calculation, which will again reduce it to the CPM or critical path method, what we did earlier. Okay. In both the cases, you are doing the critical path, you are finding out the critical path only. Only thing is, here you are having a little bit of confidence because this is there. Of course, if the person is estimating, how do you get this pessimistic time? In so many projects, I found that it will take so much of time. Because this project is in Assam, transportation is not what it was when the project was done in Kolkata. So all this is depending on the experience of the person who's doing it only. Okay. So when you are studying here in class, it is very simple because time is already given to all of you. Okay, the time is already given. But when you go out into the field, you are expected to put in the time. You get it? Right. So we'll close this lecture now. I'll meet you tomorrow at 9:30 p.m. on Moodle.